Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is July 15th, 2018. Today is the eighth Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 7323-7508. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock. Our organist is Greg Nolte. Flowers on the chancel stands are to the glory of God, from Nelson Kloppenstein in loving memory of Ruth and Nelson's anniversary. Visit us in a couple weeks. Well, coming up this Friday on the 20th of July, Clark County Fair. We have a booth in the Mercantile Building the 20th through the 27th. Please come visit us. Food pantry is Wednesdays, 9 o'clock to 10:45. Outreach store is Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 1, closed on Thursday. Rainbow table is every Friday from noon to 1.
Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Will be doing the readings.
A reading from Amos. This is what the Lord God showed me. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line. With a plumb line in his hand, the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? Then I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, see, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will raise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, said to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words. For thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile, away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go, flee away to the land of Judah. Earn your bread there, and prophesy there, but never again prophesy at Bethel. For it is the king's sanctuary, and it is the temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Amaziah, I am no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I am a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flocks, and the Lord said to me, go prophesy to my people Israel, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
What the Lord God is saying, for you speak peace.
shall prepare for the God of pathway.
A reading from Ephesians. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless before him in love. He destined us for adoption as his children through Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace that he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and insight, he has made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time to gather up all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In Christ we also obtain an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were first to set our hopes on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you had heard the words of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit, that is the pledge of our inheritance toward the redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
All the shelves empty of food.
sit there in front of the altar before the service or after the service begins. And of course, same announcement I've been sharing with you for weeks now. Fair's coming up. We still have a couple of places where we need someone to watch our booth. So the sign up sheet's outside Charlotte's office. So if you would like to sign up, please do so. Let us now sing Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, hymn number 807, in the back of your worship.
God first, honor his name, remember.
they do have all the other, honor your father and mother, not kill, don't steal, lie, and covet. So John had been attacking Herod, the son of Herod the Great, and his wife, who was Herodias. The reason he was attacking them was because Jewish law said that when a woman was divorced from a man, that especially the brother of that husband, or brother of the former husband, could not marry the woman for himself. And this is exactly what Herod had done. Philip, his brother, had been married to Herodias. They were divorced. Now Herod has married Herodias. And every time John sees them, he reminds them of the sin that they had committed. And so it didn't matter if it was a king and queen or a king and his preaching aroused so much hatred that led to his murder. And we just see a similar, maybe not quite as drastic, but we see a similar reaction in society today when the church stands up and proclaims the truth. When the church stands up and calls sin, sin, as it's supposed to, we get pulled out. We get reprisals from society because they don't want to hear that sentence. And so truth can cause us trouble, but we're still supposed to be true. Some of the ways that you get in trouble for telling the truth is, first of all, by exposing sin. As we read in our gospel lesson for today, for John had been saying to Herod, "It is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife." It is not lawful. That means it is not right. Right is right. Wrong is wrong. Now you can try to change it and go call something else, but it's still all right. It's just like if you're going in the wrong direction trying to get home. And you're supposed to be going north, but you call it south. But you're going south. Well, just because you call south north doesn't make it right. You're not going to get home because you're going down the wrong path. So that is the purpose of the church, is to put that correction on society. Remember, Jesus told us we were to be that city shining on a hill which cannot be hid. We're to be that light in a darkened room. And so we have that responsibility. Even though we sin too, but we recognize that we sin and we repent. We still have to confront society when it sins and when it begins to totally ignore what is right and wrong. Today, what society needs to do all too often is call sin a choice. I can choose whether to obey this or that. But we've gotten into this big thing about people's rights. About personal freedom. But for there to be a society, to be a civilization, people have to agree on certain rules and regulations of how to live. You have to have the same morals and same values if you're going to be a productive civilization, a productive society. And for the first 200 or so years of our nation, we had common values, common morals. They were based on the Judeo-Christian heritage. People recognized that sin was sin, and right was right and wrong was wrong. But now we have people who want to say, well, you make up your own rules, make up your own morals, make up your own values. Well, if everybody does that, we have nothing but complete chaos. And everybody will be stepping on everybody else, and we'll get back to the stronger survival. We'll get back to that period between the fall of Rome and the Renaissance, when the basic rule of Western civilization was the strongest of that. Might makes right. You had the might, you determined what was right. If you didn't have the might, you had no say. So that was one thing that our nation was founded.
popular mantra or mantra, and I mean, love the sinner but hate the sin. And that's the way it still is. When the church condemns sin, it's not condemning a person. It's calling on them to look at themselves and realize that they're violating God's law and they need to come back and repent. They need to repent, and repent, of course, it leads to salvation. But without repenting, there is no salvation. That was one of the justifications that Martin Luther used for supporting capital punishment. The idea that God had given the power of the sword to government, that is, our text. He said, a person commits a crime and they may not repent until they are faced with the fact that they are looking at execution. He said, then the person, more times than not, will repent and receive absolution and receive assurance of heaven. Their physical life will end on this earth, yes, but their eternal life, soul, will not perish. Some of you may remember in the 90s a movie that was made, and supposed to be an anti-capital punishment movie, but actually it made the point that Luther's making. I forget the name of it now, but it was about a condemned prisoner down in Louisiana, and a Susan Train played the nun, this nun that began ministering to him, and he kept denying what he had done. He kept denying the murder, he kept denying his involvement, he kept saying no, and the nun knew he was not telling the truth. Finally, when his execution date was set, it got to be about a week or so before his execution, he finally broke down and confessed to the nun that he had committed the murder, confessed everything he had done, and sought absolution. So when he went to the gas chamber or whatever it was Louisiana did back when this took place, of course the movie was in the 90s, so the events took place earlier in the 70s. The point he saw was this man repented when facing death. Had he not, had he been given life imprisonment or paroled after 20 years, he probably never would have repented. But he went to the death chamber assured. That is why it is the church's responsibility to call sin sin and not call it a change in our society or a choice that you can make for your own and have what rules you want. They are different rules from somebody else. So we repent. Repenting, we receive salvation. Repenting, we are guaranteed of salvation. But people come along and tell the church, well, we shouldn't do that. There's a difference in condemning sin and judging somebody and a term of soul. But we have the responsibility as citizens to sit on a jury and deliberate a person's fate, whether they're innocent or guilty, depending on the evidence. A judge has the responsibility of setting a sentence on that person. Maybe them to life imprisonment, or life 25 years to life, or whatever, possibly parole after 15 years, whatever. That's the judge's responsibility to judge that person and what their penalty. You're not judging an individual's soul. You're not judging whether they are going to heaven or hell. That is what Jesus is talking about when he says, judge not and be not judged. It's because the Pharisees had this horrible practice of condemning people, judging people, because they did not fulfill the law to the letter like they did. And so people like the fishermen, and the shepherds, and the tanners, and the bricklayers, and the stonemasons, and all the people who were skilled labor or farming or whatever, who couldn't fulfill all these laws, they were looked down upon by the Pharisees. They were almost in the same boat as that's what Jesus is taught. When we become self-righteous and say, well, so-and-so is not a Christian because they don't act like I do, or so-and-so doesn't really believe because this or that, that's what Jesus is taught. We can't do that as a judge. But to God, to to judge whether we're going to heaven or hell. It's up to the church to call people to repentance, to call people back to God, and to call people they haven't had a relationship with God to now have a relationship with God through their faith in Jesus Christ. Jesus establishes that relationship. A father was talking to his son, and he said to him, "Son, I want an explanation and I want the truth." The son replied to the father, "Dad, you can't have it both ways. You either want an explanation or you need the truth. You can't have it both." And that's the way society pretty much looks at that. But Jesus, in Jesus, we can have the explanation and the truth. We have that. And so that is why it's so important for us to share the good news of the gospel with them. To share the good news with that person who has not heard about the good news of Jesus Christ. Satan tells us, you sinned, you did something terrible, you can't have salvation. That puts doubt on you. We begin to doubt whether or not salvation is really for us. We start thinking that we've done something too terrible, that there's no way Jesus has any interest in us. It's a devil. All of us at times have doubt about something that we're mad at. John the Baptist, while in prison, had doubts as to whether Jesus was really the Messiah. And so he sent his disciples to Jesus and say, "Our master, our teacher John wants to know if you are the Messiah or should we look for someone else?" What did Jesus say? He said, "Tell John that the blind see, the lame walk, the dead are raised, and good news is preached. The good news of the kingdom is proclaimed." And they went back and told John, he knew that Jesus was the Messiah. Satan loves to play on our doubts. Satan loves to come along at a time when we are down and tell us we are no good, that we have no chance of salvation, that we are such a horrible and despicable person that we might as well just jump off the bridge. Jesus comes along, and Jesus tells us the truth. And believe in him, you're saved. There's an old story about Martin Luther, how he was in his study one day, and Satan shows up. And Satan starts writing on a blackboard, chalkboard, all of Luther's sins. He fills up one blackboard and then the other, remote blackboard. Luther says, "Was that all? Don't you have more?" And Satan says, "Yes, I have plenty more. But you don't have room for me to write it down, so you're condemned. You're a sinner. Jesus doesn't want anything to do with you." And Luther said, "Oh, Satan, but you're wrong. I believe in Jesus Christ, and I believe his death on the cross paid the debt of sin that I have done. And so if you have no power over me, I'll be gone." And Satan left. But he had no power. He was lying. Luther was telling the truth. Satan cannot stand. But if we tell the truth, if we point out to someone that they are sinning, oftentimes they don't answer. They want no part. They accuse you of being judgmental and throw all kinds of other names at you. But that is our responsibility. We have to do that. While at the same time admitting that we too are sinning. It's not that we think we're better. This is our call as followers of Jesus Christ. And the third thing that will get you in trouble by telling the truth is it will arouse opposition. We read in verse 19, "And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to put him to death, but she couldn't." The word grudge means to be enraged with someone. It means to set yourself against someone. It means to have an end for someone. So Herodias had an end for him. John aroused opposition from her because of telling the truth. wanted to put him to death. That is, the word wanted means to desire, to be determined. She could not, that is, she did not have the power to do so. Why did she have the power to do so? We read it in the next verse. Because Herod, her husband, feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man. The word fear means to be terrified or caused to run away. That's what effect John had on Herod. The problem was, Herod would not stand up to his wife. He let his wife influence him. For the name. John knew, or Herod knew John was a righteous and holy man. That means an innocent or just man. That's what righteous means. We're righteous before God because of Jesus Christ. We're innocent of our sin before God because of Jesus Christ, because we're washed in the blood of the Lamb. The word holy means to be sanctified, to be set apart. The word sanctified means you're set apart. We are set apart from the world to fulfill that job that was first given to the Hebrew children when they made the covenant with God at Mount Sinai, became a chosen people, and that was to be a light to the nations of the world. And they were supposed to show the world how God really wanted to live in relationship with us and one another. After rebelling and after exile and so forth, they became inclusive instead of exclusive. They just thought of themselves as the only ones who would be saved, the only ones that God cared about them. Gentiles, God didn't care about the Gentiles, so why should they? Unfortunately, sometimes we have that attitude in the church. We think, well, we're saved, so that's all that's important. Or when we talk about reaching other people with the gospel, hear the attitude of, well, the times of the service are on the board outside. They can see what time church comes and they want to come and walk in the door. Yet time and time again, it's been proven that people come to church when they're invited by someone. I gave you the example last week where our little son Joel, this fellow worker, is invited him to church. Now, it was on the church staff. So, we have been set apart to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, which involves telling the truth. Sometimes the truth calls us to be imperfect. Sometimes you have to pay a price for telling the truth. But if we're telling the truth of Jesus Christ, it is all worth it. And then we read how Herod kept him safe. That means to keep him from perishing, to guard him, to rescue him, to keep him together. So Kevin says, when he heard him, he was greatly perplexed. That is not to understand, to not know exactly what's going on. Yet he heard him gladly. Heard him gladly. See, there's people today in our society that hear the gospel gladly, they'll let you talk to them about it. But they just won't take it as faith to commit their life to Jesus Christ. And that's what we have to step in. Even that urge. Come with me. Come and see me. Come and hear about the Lord Jesus Christ and what he can do for you and do for your life. And how he can take away your fears and your troubles. All of us have gone through difficulties in our lives. We've gone through tragedies. We've lost people we love. Have you ever stopped to think how in the world does someone go through that who doesn't have faith in Jesus Christ? If they believe that life is just life and that's it, how do they find any comfort? How do they ever get over it? Whereas we have that assurance that we will see that person again and that even that Jesus is preparing a place for us in this. We have that promise of joining that great cloud of witnesses. certain areas of the world is very dangerous to proclaim the truth of Jesus Christ. Places in Africa, the Middle East, Indonesia, even in South America, can be very dangerous to proclaim the truth. But that's what we're called to do. And Jesus promises us He will be with us. Promises us that if we are martyred, there is a place that He has already prepared. And then we'll join all those other martyrs that we read about in the book of Revelation together around the throne of God and praise God each day for all we have done. So do not be afraid to tell the truth. Yes, there's a price for telling the truth of Jesus Christ. But there's a price. A price that will positively affect our society and our neighborhood. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Look to you for relief and peace, and wait in hope for the final healing.
to and from other worship.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to Almighty and merciful God, Lord, our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us a way to everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join our name in hymn.
abundance with his bread of life and cup of salvation, you united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world, and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with Go My Children with my blessing, hymn number 543, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 543.
That concludes our Sunday service. Join us next Sunday at the drive-in at 8 o'clock, the Melody Cruise Inn on East 40, east of Springfield, or at 10:30 here at St. John's in the Sanctuary at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Join us this Friday and the following week at the Clark County Fair in the Mercantile Building. St. John's Food Pantry is open Wednesday 9 to 10:45. The outreach door is open 9:30 to 1. Monday through Friday, closed on Thursday, and the Rainbow Table is every Friday from noon to 1. Everyone is welcome. Go in peace.